First of all, I want to tell you that I felt most lucky when I got to know that I would look at your work up close. And I know you said that you perhaps would not want to talk primarily in terms of animation, but I think you kind of undervalue what a wonder it is for us to see a representation which has a different materiality. Mm-hmm. So if we could wind the two together, it would be nice. I was thinking, looking at some of your other work too, at what your animation is able to do, is that often the scape is of the city and is of the walls and the pipelines. In one film, very interestingly, is just the tea bubbling in the glasses which are sold on the road. And the animation takes you into the relief that people seek from that life. Yeah. So the relief could be a fantasy, like in Painted Rainbow. It could be nostalgia for a place that you've actually run away from, like in Chai. And I was looking at this film and thinking, so, but where is the relief here? Because all the surfaces, everything is there, the lights and so on. And it struck me that perhaps the place that the animation takes you to as a space of relief in this film is, and it's a beautiful long tradition, it's the face of the beloved, actually, which, and more beautifully, I mean, and I can see that you've etched out the faces of your two characters with a lot of love. And and that's where they go. There is the Hindi film poster, and that's another question. But that is, of course, as we know, doesn't quite play out. Though there's a lovely moment when Jodha Akbar, with their complexions reversed, I imagined, again, only something animation could have done. But I was wondering if you could tell us something about these faces, which is, they are like landscapes. The most beautiful moments are when he turns back over his shoulder to look at her. Yeah, and so when their faces kind of fill the screen, it feels like that relief that your visual language provides for us to leave with these people, the city. So how these faces, why these faces, something about, because you actually make these people come alive. It's not like us putting a camera. No. You are actually giving them life. So could you tell us about these two faces in your film?
Thanks, Ansa. That's a very beautiful analogy. I mean, something nobody has told me before. But yes, all my films justify the use of animation, because at one point it goes from realism into another world. And as you said, it was dreams. It was matchboxes in Painted Rainbow. It is dreams. It's nostalgia. And this film especially has not been appreciated too much in animation film festivals, for the simple reason that in an animation film festival, people always ask the question that if something can be made in live action, why would it be made in animation? And for me, it's been, if anybody gives me that question, I have no answer, because I feel the film should speak for itself. And what you have said right now, what you have noticed, is exactly the justification next time I'm going to give to them, which is, it could have been done in live action, but it would probably not be so, not be so interesting, not be so lifted from reality in terms of showing something which is very real, but it's uplifted with art, with beauty, with an aesthetics which comes from a painting. So this is something I feel people should be able to see by themselves as an audience. Not everybody does that. So yes, my animation is extremely realistic. And because it is animation, I have a lot more control on my actors. A lot more control in terms of how I can let them express themselves. And for me, it's always a painting. Each frame is a painting. So as you say that in the dance bar, it's the boy looking back at the girl. And the thing is, in a live action film, you would probably see everybody in focus. You would do a shift focus from a face here to a face there. You cannot avoid that. But in a canvas of animation, I keep the focus on both of them and everybody else is blurred. So these are things that I use from live action, but because it is animation, I can get onto the other side and have, in the end, no lens flare happening, nobody looking into the camera by mistake and, you know, things like that. In fact, I do indulge in all those things to make them look like live action. So yes, animation is, of course, my first love, and it's not that I don't want to talk about it. What I find nice about this festival and the film being over here is it goes beyond animation. Just the technical bit of being in an animation film festival, it goes beyond that into a
but just
statement.
The choice of faces I'm asking, just because it would be it's a preoccupation of all of us when we frame, that we have a face before us and it fills the frame. So what does it, I mean, I'm just being a little insistent because I feel there's something different in your process. When you create these faces to fill the frame, how do you arrive at these faces? How is his face his and her face hers? Like, where are they from?
They, of course, are characters designed for a film that I was working in 2009 called Girgit. It had three characters. The boy is from Kashmir, the girl is from Madhya Pradesh, and there was a third character from Karnataka. And I was working on their characters at that time. And for me, it was two characters who can portray first love through their expressions and emotions, which was at the back of my mind when I was designing them. And this was way back in 2009. The film, of course, didn't happen, but the characters stayed with me so long that they became more and more refined. They had more, I mean, they are drawn characters, but their histories became more something that I was concerned with. I would look at these kids selling flowers, like in a place like Hirapanna in Bombay. And these are young boys and girls selling flowers. And there would be this wonderful exchange happening, flirtation happening between them, that got me thinking that these are faces from different parts of India. Very expressive eyes, very expressive skin. At one point, you don't know who belongs where. The languages are different, but they're speaking a Bombay language. So it was looking at a lot of these people, these girls in trains, boys in traffic signals, that kind of amalgamated into a character for me. And then I set him from Kashmir, so he's tall and he's what he looks like. It was also interesting to have beauty in terms of the existing forms of beauty, of the girl being fair, turned the other way around. And she's from Madhya Pradesh, from a tribal family, so she has these big eyes and shiny skin. And eventually, I think, symbolically, these faces became, for me, what a 19, 20-year-old in Bombay, working, surviving, ended up being.
Also, you reference a lot of, so like the blues and the deep oranges that you're able to permeate, are these, I mean, painterly sort of references or like that the color palette, I think you mentioned sometimes you work with miniatures, this is clearly not that, but so this kind of strong use of like deep blues and oranges and grays to sort of make the city for us. Are these referencing painting?
Not really painting, more photographs and more films of Bombay. Like Meeranair has been a big influence for me. Her fiction films, I've not seen her documentary films. Or the films of the live action films, fiction films from the black and white era till before the digital really came in terms of the warmth of sodium vapor, which is so Bombay. It's like, it's there in all of K.K. Mahajan's films that you would see, or even Piyusha's Money Calls films. So those are the colors that have been much more my inspiration than paintings.
Okay. And I do not know, this is a little complaint before I open it to the house, is that the Hindi film doesn't fare very well in your film. There is a film which follows all the tropes of a love story as we see it on the screen. The most beautiful parts of the love story that we take from the screen, which is, you know, the young boy, the young girl, that gaze, the kind of foolish idealism each expects of the other, and the desire to live up to that foolish idealism. are there, but the Hindi film itself and the Hindi film hero as a person on the Bombay streets is a villain, which is kind of, if I would think of a film like Om Shanti Om, for instance, where the hero has to kind of, the person who is the hero has to live up to being the hero of a film to earn that honor. But here clearly, so I think we picked up the wrong hero. I mean, this is not Shah Rukh, this is somebody
this is else.
Yeah. But I wanted to know whether there was a journey, in, or did you know from the beginning that the Hindi film was indicted in this narrative, or was it a journey in which you somewhere along your narrative realized that that part of the film was the villain somewhere, I mean, had to be there?
No, it was absolutely the goal of the film to show the irresponsibility of Bollywood as a whole. It's for me, it's a very important question to ask that if this is your fan base, if these are the kids who are saving up the money for the first day for a show, and they are the ones who get trampled under your car, what is your sense of responsibility then as a Bollywood hero? And then the Bollywood hero also signifies the government at large, people who, citizens of the city, as opposed to these people who are migrants and therefore not citizens. So what does the city owe them was, for me, through Bollywood. Because if this is what you look up to, then I mean, I took a very simple symbol to show that there is a lack of responsibility of the city, of Bollywood, of people that they look up to when it comes to reality.
You displace the love story onto their story.
Yes. I mean, I wanted it to be a Bollywood love story in that sense, totally in the Bollywood way, except with a sad ending.
Why did you want it? Okay, any, actually, I should open it up to the house now.
Should I just ask a question? I'm at the back. Gitanjali, lovely film. I have to say that at a time when the lines between documentary and fiction are now increasingly blurring, we know that, you know, this whole business of even documentary is now very much up for question, and there are all these blurring lines. I was so struck by the film and actually slightly envious of you as a as an animation filmmaker, because there are sensory experiences that you are able to express that is so difficult for us to do, or for documentary filmmakers to do. And for me, what was the most powerful thing in your film was not really the narrative and the plot and what happens in the story, but the way in which you're able to just express that whole thing, which we are always trying for, but we can't. You know, that whole traffic sequence, the blur, the rush, the sound, the screeching, the sounds of the waves, the experience of water coming over the sky, the blurring of the window with the droplets on it. And I just wanted you to speak a little more of that, because, you know, clearly there is a narrative in your film, but there is all this heightened stuff that you can express, which is coming out of sound, but it's also coming out of the images that you're creating. And maybe you just want to share that a little bit with us.
Yeah, that's the reason I want to keep doing animation films and not get on to live action, because I did work on a live action film, and at times I feel it is easier, and at other times I feel it is far more difficult than what I do. So having done animation over 22 years, this again is that little space which I feel animation has and should have and should be exploited, so that it goes beyond being a documentary or a fiction. I mean, as I watch all the documentary films over here, people are doing it so well. So when I did a live action film, which is again a hybrid feature, it looks like a documentary, but it's fiction and it's got animation going in. I felt, I enjoyed doing it. It was the only film that I got paid for making. But I just felt I am not enjoying it as much for these very reasons, you know, that little thing which I can give with animation which can't be done in live action. Because I remember in Dharamshala when I had a screening, and Rajat Kapoor told me, you can shoot in Juhu Beach. I mean, not shoot, what he meant was you can have a scene, a complete film in Juhu Beach, which is next to impossible for people to shoot because of crowd control and things like that. So yes, starting from that, everything that I do in the film actually cannot be done very easily in live action. And that is my trip in doing it in animation. So it's, yes, paintings combined with none of the logistical problems of documentary filmmaking. But what I feel is I'm probably one of the few people who's doing this in animation. I don't know why. It is not something that is favored too much in animation all over the world or in this country. In animation, you're always going into a sense of fantasy, which is unbelievable, which is uncreatable, and go into the VFX zone. But I take the other route, which is go so much into realism and then hyper-realism, and then within that create the dream and the fantasy, which is probably impossible with the medium that you choose, which is live action or fiction. So yeah, it's nice that it gets noticed.
Hi, thanks for the film. I'm over here. Huh. Hello. Thanks. I'm not a film person, but just to one comment and one question. I quite like the idea that an animator is a bit more of a megalomaniac and just likes the control that they can have over it all. I think that's. I guess in music, it would be the difference between electronic music or someone can create it on a computer and have full control over it, whereas using live musicians is more of an ensemble and having to coordinate and things. That's interesting. But the question I had was more the reason why we're in this building and it's the urban space and things. So I was wondering if you could say a little bit about creating a movie with the urban landscape and the urban space, whether it's the visual and the sound base, as opposed to, I don't know if you've created anything with rural background, and whether you feel that this sort of, the aesthetics of the urban is why you like to set this sort of film in that sort of space, or if you've done something that's a bit more rural, how would you see it differently? Thanks.
I live in Bombay and I'm born and brought up there. I've lived all my life there. So therefore it is, the stories are set in Bombay. This film is actually a short, one of the stories of a feature film that I'm working on. And the feature film is completely a story of migration, of people coming from rural setups into a place like Bombay. So the feature film is where the story of these two characters, where they come from, which is a completely rural setup, exists. This being a short film, I decided to take just one part of the story and tell it. So for me, it has always been interesting. Because I'm born and brought up in a city and surrounded by people who usually come from other places, which are rural places or other cities from India. I mean, Bombay being a very cosmopolitan place, I have always missed that. I've always missed the fact that I'm not rooted in another place. I am from a city like Bombay, which is two generations migrant. So I can't even call myself a Marathi because I'm not. So this displacement is very interesting. A lot of people feel this displacement in spite of being very, very firmly placed within the city. So another person's displacement becomes interesting for me. And to show that displacement within the city without having to go back into their rural setup was the idea in this film. So therefore, as I said, it talks about migration, but it doesn't talk about it in your face. But anybody who's from Bombay would know that these two people do not belong to the city. They have come there and made a home over there, and what the city does to them. Therefore, I think it's how it works within the urban settlement part of the theme.
I've waited to watch this film. So having done that, my question would be two things. First of all, I want to say that that really, as visuals, that really struck me was one was that transition where you did the taxi coming in and they both having a very intimate moment and how you blended that. And when the movie ends, how her sari blends with probably the accent. Those were very beautiful moments for me. Apart from that, having watched so many of your films, Mike, one thing that I would really want to know how you do is except for Orange, I don't think any of your films have dialogues. Mm-hmm. So how do you have so much control of your film, every frame, that the audience is watching this and they don't get any other idea without dialogues? You're so easily communicating every heartbeat. We are through with that. We are going along with it. We can't picture anything else. We can't think anything else. How do you have so much control? How does that process how do you get into that process? How do you get that on screen?
Thanks, that's a very nice compliment. The thing is, I have done a little bit of acting in theater, which helps me. My stories are without words. They have always been in the earlier films also. But in this film especially, what I was exploring was to speak about emotions without words. The fact that animation is a visual medium, again, I use it to tell stories visually without the help of words. So the moment I start, it's like you're moving a painting. If you look at something as a painting, which speaks a lot to you, which each person, when they look at a painting for hours together, it's what you take away from it. Few years later, you look at the same painting, it means something else. So I treat animation as an extension to painting, moving paintings. The same way that you create a composition, you create expressions that each person in the audience will have their own takeaway. But the moment you get sound, music, and you get a narrative into it, you can kind of, it goes not beyond a painting, but it goes away from a painting where you start having the control of telling a story through it. So having done animation, studied commercial art before I did, I never studied animation. This was the advantage. I have always looked at paintings and then wanted to make films, so I moved them. And using my skills of acting, whatever little I did in theater, to use expression in a way that conveys a lot through silences. So it's like I wanted to become an actor, but then I decided to do animation. So I take my actors and I actually enact the scenes myself. I don't necessarily shoot or look into the mirror, but feel in terms of body and posture, how the actor would feel at a certain emotion, and then paint it. So you keep the skill of painting also going, but you keep the skill of acting. And then the third thing, which is composition, then a fourth thing, which is lighting, all that then comes together to be able to convey what it does. So,
thank you.
Thanks. It's 12 drawings per character per second, and the traffic, I'm telling you per second, then you can multiply it. But if it's two characters, then it's 12 and 12, and the traffic is on another layer, which can be another 8 or 12 of them per second. And then there's 60 seconds, and then there is 19 minutes. So it's impossible to say how many frames.
This may have to be the last question. Yeah,
yeah. I have, okay. The quiet that you're trying to show within them, for me, it was heightened because of the noise around them, that chaos. And so you could kind of focus on them, but you're hearing all the sounds seemed so city, so urban. So I would like to hear you talk about, you know, your idea of Bombay, which is probably, for many people, it is the most urban sort of, everything that it signals is the most urban. When you think of urban, Bombay gives you everything that you can take from to signal something urban. So when you think of setting them in a place, was it any city, or was apart from the Bollywood part of it, how much did Bombay inform those signals that you're giving us to create that chaos that allows us to, you know, in which we can see these people? So I just want you to talk about, you know, whether it's a different city or whether it's Bombay or whether there's no difference in your mind.
No, I told him, and I repeat that I'm born and brought up in Bombay, and noise is something you invariably live with in Bombay forever. And Juhu Beach is one of the noisiest places if you go there on a Saturday evening or Sunday. So that is one thing. And for me, sound in terms of animation is over the years become very important. And my sound designer, Satish PM, it's almost like a partnership. 50% I feel is the visual and 50% of the film is sound. And I've worked with him over a few films. He's one of the finest sound designers of, not Bollywood, of the Indian film industry, because he does a lot of documentaries and stuff. I actually just gave him the film, and he has done the sound, knowing very well what I was hearing within my mind when I was making the film. So yes, the thing is, it was, what we discussed in the beginning was, it is a very noisy place. And what happens in live animation is, the sound designer is given footage with absolute silence, with no reference of sound at all. So the interpretation again is very creative, but is also very difficult, because there are 10,000 options you can use for each and every sound that you put together. So the idea was, we create a noisy city, but we need silences in the film. And if you just kept to a realistic sound in the film, that the whole film would have been very noisy. Even in night, even in nights, Bombay is not quiet. So we decided, if it is going to be realistic and noisy, let's take their inner spaces as places where we introduce silence. So their thoughts, being with them, being close to them, was where we have silence. And if you notice, it's not very realistic. There are times where we use certain sounds of intimate sounds of, you know, her jewelry and things like that, and to create a sense of silence, which is a complete design decision taken between the sound designer and me, saying whatever it adds, whatever is the sound of that person, whether it's like she said, you can almost hear them breathing or feel them breathing. There is no sound, but the animation makes it seem like you can hear their breath. So this was very cleverly done between the visuals and the sound. How much realism should you have, and at what point you just go abstract and you design it, but not let the people feel that, you know, they've gone into another soundscape altogether. So I've created enough spaces in the film to be able to have the silence. So then the noise of the city, this is something, if you ever live in a city all your life, what happens is, like for me, there is a lot of sound, there's a lot of crowd, but even in the middle of Churchgate station, where I used to spend my time in college and all, I would be with my thoughts. I would be very lonely. I would find the loneliness and the silence that I need in a very crowded place, which happens to people who are born and brought up in a city. It doesn't happen to people who come into a city, because for them, they've come from a silent place. They come into a very noisy place and they cannot find this. So this was also something I wanted to recreate, that in the midst of total chaos, if you go into your own mind, and it's like a meditative quality, you can create the silence. So we reproduce that in sound.
Thank you so much for your lovely film.
Thank you.